One of the most important concepts in biology is the concept of transport, and in today's video, we're going to take a look at the processes of diffusion and osmosis. Diffusion is defined as the movement of particles from an area of high concentration to an area of low concentration. And if we take a look at our picture here, you can see that on the left side of our membrane, we have a lot more red molecules as compared to the right. Well, through the process of diffusion over time, the molecules on the left, an area of high concentration, are going to move to the right side of the membrane, an area of low concentration, eventually resulting in an equal number of red molecules both on the left side and the right side of the membrane. This process of diffusion is passive in the fact that it does not require energy in order for these molecules to move from that area of high concentration to that area of low concentration. One way you can think of this is to think about adding a drop of food coloring to a beaker of water. When you first add the food coloring, it will be an area of high concentration, and over time the dye is going to spread itself out to areas of low concentration, eventually resulting in your beaker of water turning a particular color. You can try this process of diffusion at home by simply taking a bottle of cologne or perfume and simply opening it up and leaving it in the room. Over time, the room is going to begin to smell like the cologne or the perfume because molecules within the bottle are going to diffuse from the area of high concentration, the bottle itself, to an area of low concentration, the rest of the room. The diffusion of water is known as osmosis, so if we look at our diagram here, we can see that there are more water molecules, these blue spheres that you see on the left, as compared to the right. And over time, the water molecules will go from an area of high concentration to an area of low concentration. Now, in addition to water molecules, there is also going to be solute molecules, and there is an inverse relationship. So when you have more water molecules, you will have less solute molecules, and when you have less water molecules, you'll have more solute molecules. Cells, when they are placed in solutions with a certain percent of water and a certain percent of solute, are going to respond in different ways. So if we take a look at our first diagram here on the left, if a cell is placed in a solution where there is more solute and therefore less water outside the cell as compared to inside the cell, then the cell is said to be placed in a hypertonic solution. If a cell is placed in a solution where there is an equal amount of solute and water from both inside the cell and outside the cell, then the cell is said to have been placed in an isotonic solution, iso for being the same. And finally, if a cell is placed in a solution where there is less solute and more water outside the cell as compared to inside the cell, then the cell has been said to have been placed in a hypotonic solution. Depending upon if you have an animal cell which lacks a cell wall or a plant cell which has a cell wall, different cells are going to respond differently when they've been placed in hypertonic, isotonic, or hypotonic solutions. So if we consider the first, when placed in a hypertonic solution, animal cells, which again lack a cell wall, water is going to leave the cell, and as a result, your cell is going to shrivel up. While in a plant cell, the membrane is going to stretch away from the cell wall, eventually resulting in the cell undergoing a process known as plasmolysis. When cells are placed in an isotonic solution, our animal cell, because the cell has the same solute and water concentration, inside the cell as it is outside the cell. There will be movement of water in and out of the cell, but there will be no net change in the size of the cell. In the case of the plant cell, same thing, water will be coming in and out of the cell, but there will be no net change, and as a result, that plant cell will remain flaccid. Finally, in a hypotonic solution, when our animal cell is placed in a solution where there is less solute and more water, water is going to enter into the cell, eventually resulting in that animal cell swelling up and bursting. While in the case of the plant cell, water again is going to enter the cell, but because of the presence of the cell wall is going to keep the plant cell intact, and the plant cell is going to be turgid. Next, we're going to show you how we can see the effect of cells being placed in a hypertonic, isotonic, or hypotonic solution in the lab using some red blood cells and some plant cells. So we can look at osmosis in some sheep blood using some blood and a slit lamp. So what we have here is a piece of fabric and a thin thread that is in this opening. And this thin thread is going to allow us to see if any red blood cells have been lysed when they've been put into a hypotonic solution. So I'm going to begin first with saline, and this is 0.9% saline, and this is an isotonic solution. So when I incubate red blood cells in this solution, they should not lyse and they should remain intact. So I will take my saline and add it to a test tube. I will then take my sheep blood and add a few drops of sheep blood to the saline. Mix and then turn on the light and then look to see if I can see the thread. If I can see the thread, then that shows that the red blood cells have lysed. If I can't see the thread, then the red blood cells are still intact. And as we said, in an isotonic solution, the cells will remain intact. Therefore, we do not see the thread. Therefore, the cells are intact. I can do the same thing with water. So water is going to be a hypotonic solution compared to the red blood cells. So I'll fill up my test tube with some water. And once again, take a few drops of sheep blood, add it in, give it a mix, turn on my light. And if you look, you can see the thread. So that shows me that my blood cells have been lysed, and therefore now it's clear, and we can see the thread being shined through the test tube. Again, as a comparison, here is my red blood cells in an isotonic solution. So you see it's still turbid, and I can't see the thread, so the cells are still intact. While here, we see that the solution has turned clear because the red blood cells have been lysed because they were in a hypotonic solution. Isotonic, they're still intact. Hypotonic, the cells have been lysed. To look at osmosis in a plant cell, we can take a piece of jade leaf or Elodea if you have it. So I'm going to take my leaf and I'm going to cut a very thin slice, add it to my slide, add a drop of water, add my cover slip, and press gently,
And now I'll put this on the microscope so we can get some plant cells in focus.
Here we have a plant cell. We can see the cell wall. We can see the green spots here corresponding to the chloroplasts that have the green chlorophyll. And now I have a solution of sodium chloride, which is going to be hypertonic to the plant cell. So I'm going to take my solution and add it onto the slide. So I'm going to add my sodium chloride. So the way I'll do that is move the objectives away, and I'm going to add the sodium chloride to one side of the cover slip and use a piece of paper towel to draw the liquid across. I will then go back into my objective and now look to see if the plant cells have plasmolyzed. Here is a cell that's undergone plasmolysis. I can see that by the fact that the chloroplasts are much more closer together as compared to the original cell where the chloroplasts were all spread out. So this cell has been in a hypertonic solution, which means that water has left the cell, and as a result of that, the membrane has started to move away from the cell wall, and the components that are inside the plant cell have now moved closer together.